I want to go from 1905 to 1906 as if that good lunch didn't happen, okay? 1906, and then after we finish this decade, I am, as the director said, going to make two or three comments about the questions that we have to answer, and then we'll go to Q&A. Every decade in the para emergence has mattered. The 60s just cry out to be done. Man, you could have more fun with the 60s, I'm telling you. But the first decade is the one that perhaps is most pertinent when we're on a short schedule like today. And while 1905 is hugely important, and I mean it, I said to one of you a minute ago, I would not allow any person, young or old, to go to seminary now without at least an undergraduate degree in some form of physics. I think we're to that level of integration. I was at a meeting about 6 months ago when two young directors came up to me. I would say 33, 34, something like that. And they were laughing, and they said, "We just wanted to tell you that 4 years ago we heard you say nobody should go to seminary without a physics degree, and we both thought you were right. We were already ordained, so we dropped out. We went and we got the physics degree, and lady, you rock." I said, "Good for you. I'd love to know what their parishes think." But anyway, it is absolutely true. But I want to shift from physics to 1906 and Azusa Street. And Azusa Street is probably familiar to many of you, but let's do it again. Azusa Street. In 1904, there was a young man, African-American, born in Mississippi. He was born free. His mother was named Phyllis, so I'm partial to this story. She was born in slavery and freed by the war. He had been reared Christian. But about the time he was 16 or so, he began to become a little agitated, and he began to kind of drop out. And then by the time he was 18, he came back full steam ahead, saying that the problem was that there had been more to Christianity than what he was getting, what he'd been reared for. There had to be there, and he was looking for it. And he more and more began to articulate, "I want to know what it was that happened at Pentecost. I want to know what it was that happened in that room. I want to feel those first three chapters of the book of Acts." That's an emergence cry, though he's way back here in the peri-emergence. The need to feel it. They're deeply incarnational. That's part of what's going on about the music. The thing about praise music that's important is you do this with it. You know, you don't sit there and listen to it. It's, "I want to feel my faith. I want something." And he wanted to feel his faith. He worked his way across the southern part of the United States, from Mississippi over to Stockton Mile in Texas, Stockton Mile in Kansas. He was with the Farnhams, he was with the New Thought folk, but ultimately ended up in LA, in Los Angeles, on Bonnie Gray Street, where a cousin lived. And he began to preach, and he preached every single night, right up until the time that so many people came that the porch fell off of the cousin's house, and the cousin took it personally. And evicted, in my part of the world, we call that locking the barn door after the horse is stolen, but nonetheless, he evicted him. Seymour went down to Azusa Street, where there was an old stable. I love the romanticist, and he loves the fact it was a stable. It had been a stable that had been consecrated, made into a Methodist chapel. The Methodists had abandoned it after about 5 or 6 years. It had been deconsecrated and turned back into a stable, and Seymour went down there and consecrated it back into a holy place for Christian worship. And he began to preach. And he preached the second week of Seymour's preaching. The Spirit fell on two of the people present, two men who were present there. The next day, during the preaching, the Spirit came and filled the room. And there were tongues of fire, the flames descending. There was glossolalia, and there was synagogue. That is, there was the speaking in unknown tongues, and there was speaking in known tongues that were unknown to the speaker at the time of the speaking. Now, you can do whatever you want to, within limits, because what we just did was birth of Pentecostalism, right? I mean, it's clearly this is the birth of Pentecostalism. Before you get too sure that it didn't happen, You need to probably go look at the, if you want to, at the LA Times for 1906 and see what hardcore reporters had to say as they witnessed what was going on. Those tongues of flame were there. The miraculous healing, broken bones set immediately with no scar, complex fractures, thing after thing. I'm aware that there's such a thing as psychosomatic, there's such a thing as group hysteria, there's such a thing as psychosomatic illness. I know that. I've been cured of it 2,000 times in 60 years of marriage, I know, to a physician, because I will go in and give you my symptoms, and he will say, that was not in the book, sweetheart, so suck it up, and I'm cured. It just works that way. But you can't unsay what happened in Azusa Street. Seymour was going to preach there for, it would be almost 3 years before the people would begin to leave there and spread out all over the known world. As you know, theologically speaking, the most rapidly growing form of Christianity is Pentecostalism. About a quarter to a third of emergence come up out of Pentecostalism. It's heavily infused emergence thinking. It is engaging the life of the Spirit. Now, what happens at Azusa Street is, there's several things that happen. For the first, the most obvious is that everybody is welcome. It doesn't matter your social class, it doesn't matter your gender, none of it matters. As long as God the Spirit is engaging you, as long as there is evidence that you are having an experience with God the Spirit, you are welcome. Women are perfectly willing, are perfectly welcome to speak. It's the first time in American religion that women, bless not true, but it's the first time in a large movement that women are empowered to just get up and speak. You don't have to be wealthy. It's absolutely true that two very wealthy LA matrons supported Seymour during the years of this initial ministry. But the poor were there, the homeless were there. There was no racial distinction. Caucasian American, Latin American, Asian American, a Native American, it didn't matter. They were all there and they were all equal before the bar because the Spirit was dealing with all of them. What's important about Azusa Street, and I hate being criticized, but I really hate being criticized for something I didn't say, so please hear me well, because this one has gotten me in lots of trouble. The truth of it is that until Azusa Street came, there was no corporate, reproducible, and recurrent engagement with the Holy Spirit from Pentecost until Azusa Street, with very few exceptions. I did not say that the Holy Ghost wasn't active in history. I didn't say that. I did not say that it is not true that the medieval mystics particularly engaged with and were engaged by the Holy Spirit. They absolutely were. There's a period in the last half of the 19th century when one branch of Russian Orthodoxy, a very small branch, begins to have experience of the Holy Spirit repeatedly, night after night, where there are all the physical evidences of the Holy Spirit. It doesn't last more than about 20 years, it goes away. There were, just before Azusa Street, there were 2 weeks in Sweden where a congregation enjoyed the presence of the Holy Spirit. There was a little church, it's about as big as two John outhouses put together, right on the line between eastern Tennessee and western North Carolina, in my country, straddling the line. And the Holy Spirit came for a couple of weeks. That church has been reconstructed, moved to the Assembly of God's University, and in their archives you can actually see that little building still. Where the Holy Spirit came. It was documented. There was no question that it was happening. And then there was one, I love this one. When I get up here to talk to you guys about this, it amuses me. There was one period just before Azusa Street where the Holy Spirit came for 24 hours to Toronto. But there's something about you all. The Holy Spirit doesn't like you much. He doesn't stay long. You know, he buzzes through. I don't know. But anyway, whatever. You can find it. But consistently, night after night after night, healing after healing after healing, glossolalia after glossolalia, it was there. And Pentecostalism had come. It had been born. Now, by the 50s, it's going to give rise to charismatic Christianity also. And they're going to become. The point is that whatever else emergence Christianity is about, it is about the engagement of the third part of the Trinity. In a way that is different from that engagement, how that engagement has been conducted ever before. It is the medieval mystics, Harvey Cox, who with Martin Marty, is perhaps one of the two most respected religions working in the English language. I don't think there's any question about it, as a matter of fact. I won't apologize for it. Harvey Cox published a book 2 years ago, this time in March, called The Future of Faith. And if you don't read anything else, I suggest you read that book, in which he argues that what we're going through right now in the Great Emergence is more analogous to the Great Transition or the Great Transformation than it is to anything in the middle. Alright? In which he argues that we are in the business for the next 2,000 years of completing the Trinity, of completing, of introducing and enjoying and occupying intercourse with the third part of the Trinity. The medieval mystics, and in the first 40 pages of the Future of Faith, Harvey Cox talks about them repeatedly. The most loquacious of the medieval mystics was perhaps Joachim of Torre. Joachim and company, writing in the last part of the 12th century, the first part of the 13th century, prophesied that there would be 7,000 years to human dispensation. And that immediately makes everybody, including me, nervous when we start doing that kind of thing. I go, I'm not so sure. But what they argued was, and this is, we're now way back, we're 700 years back. What they argued was, and Joachim was profound, that there were 2,000 years of God the Father. And those 2,000 years went from the Garden of Eden to Calvary. And then, now in 1305, then there would be 2,000 years of God the Son, of Christus Victor, if you will, that would go from Calvary to the year of our Lord, he said, Anno Domini, we say, Calendar, of 2,000, which is us. When we would then begin 2,000 years from 2,000 of the common year, or to 4,000 of the common year, we would begin 2,000 years of God the Holy Spirit, in which we would complete the full Christian experience. Now, one can laugh and say he didn't ever say what to do with the last 1,000 years, probably because Kimball Hay and Jerry Jenkins weren't around to tell him what to do with the last 1,000 years. And we can laugh about it, and I think you have to because it's so deadly serious and so absolutely scary. Having laughed about it, I think also we have to recognize, because emergence leader after emergence leader is telling us now, and because perhaps our own guts tell us, that the move to be spiritual and not religious is not just a cliche. That something has shifted, and that something that has shifted is an emphasis for the first time in Christian history on God the Holy Spirit. That's not to say the exclusion of God the Son or God the Father. I didn't say that. But the completion of recognition that we must somehow engage God the Holy Spirit, with the understanding that also our definition of spiritual engagement has changed. That is, up until now, and for those who are not emergents, spirituality has been a deeply personal thing. It has been about the saving of the individual soul. It has been seen as something constant. Whereas for the emergence Christian, spirituality is an evolving thing. It has everything to do with an increasing understanding of the world itself and of creation. It has very little to do with the life hereafter compared to the fact that it has everything to do with the life here and now and making the kingdom come here. That it is not deeply personal, it is deeply communal. And that the difference after difference about what spirituality is, about what the individualized pursuit of God is, the traditional definition of spirituality. Emergents are very afraid of that. They say it's not the individual pursuit of God. It is the pursuit of God in such a way that all of the world around us, that we become conduits, that it is an ongoing thing, that the Spirit works through us into the world here. It's not me locking myself up on a retreat somewhere. It's me opening up so that it flows through me this way. It's a different engagement of the Spirit. It deeply influences what emergents do. Now, when they get ready to answer the authority question, and they're very clear about this, because they know they're going to have to answer the authority question, no question about that. When they get ready to answer the authority question, they're very sure that authority is in part not a rest on Scripture. No question. They are far more in love with the Scripture than the average traditional Christian. That always amazes me. The passion for the Word of God is much greater among emergents than it is among inherited church people, if you can make that kind of broad statement. It's, the authority is going to rest there, and the authority is going to rest in the community. There's no question about that. In communal discernment. And then it's going to rest somehow in the Spirit or in the Trinity itself. They're not quite sure. But back here in community, they're very sure. They say it this way. It's a funny way to put it. It's a humorous way to put it. They say, when the Scripture says something to me, and in my heart, in my experience with the Spirit, in my direct conversation with the Spirit, I seem to get a different message from what I'm reading in the Bible, and I have a conflict between the two, and I can't decide which one is which. Ultimately, I'm going to go with the Spirit, but I have to be very sure that I'm hearing correctly. And so I have to go to the community. I have to go to two or three of my valid prayer partners who understand that we will sit together if it takes 4 hours, if it takes all night, if it takes 2 or 3 days. We will sit together in prayer until we understand what it is the Spirit is really telling me to do. And then they will laugh and say, if you don't do that, I don't know whether it's the Spirit that told me to do something or the pizza I ate last night for supper, which is a good reservation. You know? So that there is a concentrated, concerted, intentional use of the community for the purpose of discernment. And that's where their authority is going to come from now. Why this matters? Why this matters is, and Cox argues it beautifully. If indeed we have entered into the age of the Spirit, if indeed we are continuing the engagement with the Trinity, then everything about how we practice Christianity changes. And part of what changes most obviously is a lot of the paraphernalia that we've dressed it up with. And the paraphernalia translates to a lot of bishops and a lot of adjudicatories, and to a lot of real estate, and to a lot of other things that emergents aren't really sure they want. They believe, and this gets a little new agey, but, and I'll get over this in a minute, if you just ride with me. When you are listening to music on the radio, and the music is quite lovely, and it comes through the radio into you, if in a moment of anger you bash the radio, does the music stop? No. The music continues, it's just that the interface between you and the music has been interrupted. They would argue that in all probability, the human mind, when we come to understand it, is like the radio. That the music, which is God, which is the ultimate truth, which is all the beauty that we worship, is received through the mind, and it's limited by the mind. And as we adjust the mind, if we do whatever, we limit or we change how the music is. And the business of spirituality is to understand that there is a communication between that great beauty, that great thing, and us. And that it transcends the mind in every way. That it is an engagement that we must indeed take on for ourselves. And so they are deeply spiritual in a way that is confusing to many of us. And they speak of Christianity without religion. Or they speak of religionist Christianity. First of them was, of course, Bonhoeffer in 1943, just before he was killed, to use that term. And you will find people like Diamond Butler Bass, for instance, writing books called Christianity Beyond Religion. What they are talking about is getting at the music that's beyond the radio, and somehow trying to circumvent the radio, not let the mind interfere. Now, there are dangers in that approach, absolutely. And you can throw out the baby with the bathwater. Nonetheless, it's much of what they're trying to do. And the authority question, when they get to it, is going to rest on Azusa Street in part. It's going to rest on a full engagement with the Spirit in a way that many of us in this room are not comfortable with. That doesn't make it any less accurate or godly or predictive of where Christianity is going to go. Now, Having done that, there are two or three other things here that need to be mentioned. In 1907, we get the first real serious scholarship about emergence. Walter Rauschenbusch writes a book called Christianity and the Coming Social Crisis of the 21st Century. And the first 40 pages of it, he says, we're back into reformation, lowercase r, hyphen, lowercase f. But he nails it. We're back into this. There's no question. 1908, we get the Model T. We've always had cars, you know, but suddenly, that's not true, but Carl Benz has been making cars since 1880 or something like that. But when you get the Model T, you get that other 10 list. You get the first cheap one. And why does that matter? It matters because now you can go somewhere on Sunday. And you can watch the deterioration of Sabbath from the Model T right on. It ceases to be Sabbath or Shabbos, and it becomes the Lord's Day, and then it becomes Sunday, and then it becomes our day off. And it's a direct result of the ability to move around. All of those things are there. What I want to do, because our time is a bit limited, is I want to deal with not only the authority question, but I want to say to you that every time we go through one of these cookies, every time we go through whatever you want to call it, tsunami, whatever, there are at least two and sometimes three questions that are concomitant, but that are particular to that era, to that upheaval. We got lucky. We got three that we have to answer, and we have about 90 years left to answer. The first of the three is perhaps the easiest, though it's painful. That is, we're going to have to evolve the theology of religion. We're going to have to find a way in which we can be devout followers of particular faith and live in social and economic and civil peace with those who are devout members of another and antithetical faith. Put in a, you know, that's a polysyllabic way of saying primarily that Christianity is going to have to find a way to deal with Islam or to live in civil peace with Islam. And that's not going to be easy. You in Canada have a huge advantage that we in the States don't have in being serious. Little Mosque on the Prairie is a huge, it really is. We can't even see it in my country. You have to jump hoops. I've seen one or two episodes, and it took me forever to download it in scratches and pieces, because they won't jump the board with it. But when you can deal with popular television with something like Little Mosque on the Prairie, you have a huge advantage because you diffuse part of it. We don't have that in this country, in my country. We sure don't have it in the UK. But the problem is, we follow a man, we follow a God who says, unless you eat of this flesh and drink of this blood, you will not see the kingdom of God. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. But he also says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. There are other sheep that are nigh, other sheep that are not of this flock. What's going on here? Where do we find the place in which we can accommodate? And more to the point, how can we create a state that is not theocratic? How can we create a civil union in which all people are welcome without any theocratic, without Sharia law having to happen, without Christian law having to happen? How can we create that? What is the theology that allows us to see not every fool knows that all the world's major religions are the same in their wisdom and in their morality, more or less. It's in their mysteries that they differ. And it is equally true that we become the mystery before which we bow down. Therefore, Christianity and Islam and Judaism are never going to be all the same. How is it that we take care of that? What do we tell our young people? What do we tell our lawmakers? The three questions that appertain to the Great Emergence, other than the authority question, have social and civic and political implications just as surely as they have religious ones. And this one has huge civil and political and legal implications, and it's the church that's going to have to solve them. And you can sit here and say, oh, I don't want to talk about this, or oh, I want to make nice and go to an interfaith dinner. And an emergence will say, well, good, go to your interfaith dinner, but you haven't done anything except make nice. You haven't dealt with giving the society the basis on which to function, and giving your congregants the basis on which to be Christian and live also in a state where they serve at different. It's a huge issue, but I still think it's the easiest. The second one is, we don't know what a human being is. It's the first time we haven't known what a human being is. And this is very close to the mind business in the broken radio. I have here a bunch of handouts if somebody would come and give everybody one. Just pass them by. I don't care if you read what it says or not. We didn't hand them out to you beforehand, because if you hold them very long, it loses its pizzazz. This is a game, okay? Don't take it. This is after lunch, and we're about to go to Q&A. So this is just for fun, seriously, okay? It's a joke, if you will, out of Psychology 101, or you can see it that way anyway if you want to. Actually, it's taken from Bravo magazine. Some of you may know that magazine. I sit on their editorial board, and I can violate their copyright for that reason, which is why we're using this one. Okay, what do you see? Faces. Okay, faces and bases, or if you will, chalices. Most clergy will call them chalices, but thank you. Whatever. Some of you see the bases, right? The black part. And some of you see the faces, the white part, right? Everybody see one or the other? Now can each of you see both? Okay, they're both there. They truly are there. This is not something that's going to make you get stupid. I don't think that. Whichever one you saw first, look at it. If you saw the faces first, stare at it. If you saw the faces first, stare at them. Okay? Concentrate on whichever one you saw first. Now, having done that, switch and look at the other. If you're looking at faces, now look at faces. If you're looking at faces, if you were, now look at faces. Now swap back. If this is a normal group, which I have no reason to assume it is, somewhere between 7 and 10% of you felt something happen in your head. Anybody do it? Anybody feel a little funky thing? Yeah, about three of you. Okay, not a normal group. What happens when you do what you just did is you change hemispheres in the brain. You're resident in one, and you change to the other. The left sees faces, the right sees shapes. You went back and forth like this. What you feel, what about 7 to 10% of the people will feel, is you feel the actual switching. The strange thing about that is you feel it in an area of the body that's not innervated, which is really strange. The other strange thing about it is, who told you to switch? Who made the switch? Who did the switching? Who? And who is with you? The hemisphere that understands language. Bingo, absolutely right. The hemisphere that understands language did it. There was no self in there that did it, right? It was a mental process that did not involve any part of your physical body except this right here. Descartes answered the question. It was a proto-question out of the Reformation, and we all know it. When he said that I think and therefore I am, that was his way of proving that we absolutely were. And he postulated that there was a little homunculus in the hypothalamus. That is to say, if I shot myself here and here, they would meet in the hypothalamus, okay? And he postulated that there was a little creature in there, which was itself. And that the self sat there kind of like a guard in a big building watching TV screens at night. You know, the little homunculus was sitting there and it was watching what was going on all day long, and it was running your life. It was running your body. That's what it was. And that worked fine for about 100 years until we started doing autopsies and opened up the hypothalamus and said, there's nobody home. Which was a great story, you know. So we began to postulate the presence of a self. That was not in the hypothalamus, but that was nonetheless a self. And we began to panic, and some of you will remember this. We began to get really nervous about it, because we couldn't find it, we couldn't figure out what it was. And one of the things that the Reformation did give us was a sense of individualism, a sense that we really, there was somebody there. The first piece of literature, novel, in Western literature, is La Celestina in Spanish literature, 1497, I think, where are you? No, it's about the 1497, La Celestina. Why does that matter? It matters because you can't write, you cannot write or read a novel unless you assume that there is somebody in there who is analogous to the thing I'm receiving here, and therefore we can talk about it as a shared experience in such a way that she will be enough like it so she'll understand the conversation we're having. A novel is a sign, is an evidence, birth of novels, is a sign or an evidence that we're beginning to get a sense of the interiority of what's going on. And you can follow it straight into the pattern emergence when you get Mesmer. Remember Mesmer? Yeah, Mesmer, who said, there's somebody in there, and if you just watch me, I can make you do whatever I want you to do. And we get Mesmerism out of it, right? Exactly. He's followed by his pupil, if you will, Sigmund Freud, who says, there's somebody in there, and she's so dirty. Can we play? And then you get James, and you throughout the whole peri-emergent, you get this progression of understanding of individualized, which then begins to say, but we are made. We're back to Darwin. We're made in imago Dei, or imago Dei, however you want to say it. We're made in the image of God. And what is it about us, therefore, that is the image of God? What is it about our, as we understand, as we begin to birth psychology, as we begin to birth all of those sciences, what is it that is the imago Dei? What is it that resembles God? And we began to say, and some of you will remember this, we began to say by the 20s and 30s of the period emergence, scientists are saying, we are, it's because, Descartes was right, it's because we think, there's no homunculus there, but it's our thinking that determines that. Now, anybody who's ever lived with a cat and thinks that animals don't think is crazy, watch it. It didn't last long. And then we began to say, we differ from the animals because we have an autobiographical self. Remember this one? And then it turns out that elephants, thank you, Jane Goddard, elephants have a better autobiographical self than we do, as a matter of fact, they're much better at it. And then we think, okay, the imago Dei, the thing that makes us human, the thing that makes us better than animals is we have language. Anybody who looked at Porpoise research lately, they have an exquisite language, an intricate one. That's not what makes us human. So what is it that makes us human? What is it that is imago Dei? What does it mean to be a human being? All of philosophy, all of Western science, all of most of world science, as a matter of fact, and philosophy, has dealt with the question of who am I? As any good emergence will tell you, it's a stupid question because nobody really cares. Nobody really cares because we don't know what we are, much less who you are. And until we can solve that one, it's silly to ask who you are. And so we get to the 1960s, and we get to Timothy O'Leary and company, right? And we get to the drug age. And the drug age, like every knife, cuts two ways, good and bad. And what O'Leary and company showed us very quickly is that if I give you the same amount of the same drug at the same time of day, and you've drunk the same amount of stuff, and eat the same amount of stuff, and slept the same amount, in other words, if everything is controlled, I can predictably and reproducibly change you from person A to person B, back and forth again. And both A and B will have an autobiographical self. You are not schizophrenic. You are just entertaining to what we have up to now regarded as persons in the same physical body. And that was very upsetting to theologians, very upsetting to physicians as well. Which one is you? Nobody knows. Are we indeed nothing more than a chemical wash over a bunch of neurons in our heads? Or are we something else? And if so, what is it? We honestly do not know what it is that a human being is. And until we do, all of society is resting like this, waiting for an answer. And it's the most pressing answer in the world for the church right now. That is to say, how can you decide the abortion issue until you know what a human being is? How can you decide the end-of-life issues until you know what a human being is? How can you decide capital punishment until you know what a human being is? How can you decide the issues of bioengineering unless you know what a human being is? How can you decide what to do with singularity and transhumanism, and those things are breathing down our necks right now, until we know what a human being is? How much of human DNA can you take and put with a machine? And don't kid yourselves, it's happening. How much of that can you do and still have it be human? How much of it becomes a machine? What is robotics? What is cybernetics? We don't know. And it's the most pressing question in the world, because all of us is that. If you don't know what transhumanism is, first of all, shame on you. And second, go home and Google it. If you don't know what the singularity is, go home and Google it. You owe it to your people. You owe it to your congregants. You go home and be aware. University, MIT, Oxford University, the work of Nick Bostrom, these are not fools and idiots. These are credentialed scholars who are beginning to push on this question, and we truly don't know who told you to go from basis to basis. We have no idea what mechanism you just used. None at all. We do know that when they talk about spirituality and the image of the busted radio, that they're very close to this same issue. That is to say, if the mind is indeed a construct of chemistry, then there is something beyond the mind that connects with the music, and it's the mind that's sort of in the way. And spirituality as emergence, understand it. We have to answer this question. We have to, for the sake of society, for the sake of the church. And the third one, somehow to me, seems to be the most difficult. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's me. The third one is that we have to come up with a new understanding of the atonement. And it's imperative that we do it. Yes, some of you should have given some of that now. Of course you can. It's all well and good to laugh or jest or whatever about divine child abuse. But I don't think that's funny, and I don't think many emergents even use that expression. It's sort of a creation of those who are outside living in. What emergents will say, and again, I'm painting with a broad brush because I'm talking about millions of people as if they were an entity, but what emergents will say is, let's get this straight. You want me to believe in an omniscient God who couldn't find out a better way to solve the thing than kill his kid? And if you push them, they will go a little farther and say, let's get this straight. You want me to believe in God the Father, and he has only one child, and he kills him? That's not a daddy I need. What they are protesting, of course, is blood substitution, appeal substitution, blood sacrifice, whatever you want to call it. Those of you who have been to seminary are aware that there are at least six, according to how you slice and dice it, six, perhaps as many as eight, different theories of the atonement that the church has entertained over the last 2,000 years. The one that we grew up under, everybody in this room, had its origin in 1097 with the work of Anselm of Canterbury in a book called Pur Homines, Why God Became Man. Pur Homines, that we brought. Why God Became Man. Anselm was the only sitting bishop in the church at that time, in the Western church, who desperately opposed the Crusades, who went to Rome with all the other bishops who were gathered there and who protested. This is wrong, we have no business in Ophir, we have no business in Jerusalem, we can't do this. When he lost, he went back and rested for about 6 weeks in France, and then went on back to Canterbury. And there at Canterbury, he wrote the book, Why God Became Man. And basically, scholar after scholar has said that much of what Anselm was doing was analogous in some ways to telling a young Islamic, if you'll strap these cartridges around you and go blow yourself up in a crowded spot, 20 virgins will be waiting for you in heaven. I don't think that's quite fair, but that's close to what Anselm was trying to do. He was trying to console those Viet men, young and middle-aged, who he knew would not come back. There was no way they could come back. And he was offering them some kind of Christian solace when he wrote that book. Now, one of the great ironic things in Christian history, or ironic to me, is the fact that Peter Abelard very quickly realized the fallacy of what Anselm had written, and was beginning to take it on when Eloise distracted his attention. And he never got back to it. We would have stomped it to death then if it had not been for Eloise. But nonetheless, she came along, and maybe that was God's will. By the time we get to the Reformation and Luther and company take on Ansel's theory, they turn it into penal substitution. They turn it into the bloody sacrifice that you and I, most of us, grew up on. Emergence are saying that won't wash. First of all, it presumes that Almighty God is engaged in an equal fight with evil. And that's not compatible in any way with our understanding of God as omnipotent and omniscient. It's also incompatible with the section of Isaiah in which God says, out of me does evil come. And so we have to find something. The central question for emergence is, Eloi, Eloi, miyama sabachthani, what is he saying? What was he saying when he said those words? In the only section of course of Christian scripture that are transliteration of the Hebrew, he's quoting the first verse of one of the Psalms. But what does it mean? What actually happened? And what is the nature of the atonement? We have to answer that. We have to answer that for emergence, and we have to answer that for ourselves. Because much of what we've been taught won't wash anymore. It just won't. Now, having said all of that, I want to go to Q&A. I want to thank you for having been a wonderful audience. This could go on forever, as you know. But the record's getting ready to come play a microphone person here, and we'll see where Q&A takes us. And any of you who wish to, and normally if I had not talked so much, we would have broken into groups, three groups, and I would have asked one group to deal with the atonement, one with the nature of what the self is, and one with the theology of religion. There's not time to do that. But if anybody wishes to make a statement as well as ask a question about the atonement, it certainly would be welcome, I think, for the rest of us. But shall we go to an open session?
Factual rather than factual. You said that a couple of times.
Yes, I
did. And you told a story about a young man and a virgin birth, which I need to repeat. But his final statement went something like this. It's too beautiful not to believe it or something.
No. It's so beautiful it has to be true whether it happened or not.
That's right. It's okay. Thank you. By the way, my question has to do with the basis for that reaction. It sounds to me like an aesthetic reaction.
That would be true.
And therefore, we're back to Oscar Wilde and John Ruskin and William Morris and those folks in the late
19th century. Back to Milton, yeah.
I'm sorry, I didn't get that much education in aesthetics. What do we have to do then as the church if people are not going at this from a Cartesian point of view, but rather from an aesthetic point of view, which is quite different? I mean, I'm a musician, I like it, but we have to know this, because this is a big shift.
It's a huge shift. Thank you, sir. It's a huge shift.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. I don't know. I said I could make a laundry list of things that concern me, and you hit one of them. You cannot throw out the truth. What is it? Christianity, how long do you have? Christianity is a river. This is not a new image, okay? This is an old tried truth. It's best seen probably as a river, and then it's fed by many tributaries, all of which ultimately are making the big river. And obviously the big tributaries are things like Orthodoxy and Coptic Christianity and Asian Christianity, the things we haven't even touched today because we've talked just about westernized things. But within the westernized tributary, there are divisions. There is indeed Catholic, the Protestant, and now the emergent. And they're all coming together to make this thing that is ultimately Christianity for all of us. The thing about that, one of the things that concerns me, is exactly what you said. When we decide the nature of truth, we cannot throw out the tradition. We cannot ignore the fact that even though we're Latinized, we function within a budget that's global and not entirely Latinized. In fact, the Latinized is increasingly small and ragged. When we function within Latinized Christianity, we can't act like we're the only fish in the pond. Emergence can't either. There is an obligation on the part of Inherited Church, on the part of Jerusalem, I think, to be sure that there is enough conversation between established church and fresh expressions of church to make the tradition part of the truth. And if you don't have the tradition, you need it. There's a wonderful story. Ray Anderson was at Fuller Seminary up until his death about 3 or 4 years ago, a much-loved professor of church history. And Fuller is one of the few seminaries that emergence will go to with great comfort because it's non-denominational. There has been denominational, therefore isn't a programming institution. It really is an educational one. Then Ray wrote a book to some, 8 or 10 years ago now, called Emerging Theology for Emerging Churches. He was using the I and she because it didn't matter at that time, in which he said, it's 140 pages, kind of a classic now, in which he said, in the beginning there was the church in Jerusalem, and there was the church in Antioch. And it was by the grace of God and the grace of buildings, if you will, of the fathers in Jerusalem that they perceived something good was happening in Antioch, that God was doing something. And that they cared enough to send Paul and Barnabas over to Antioch to talk to those people so there would be some exchange like this. And it was by the grace of God and the grace stillness of the fathers in Antioch that they perceived that they needed, if not the imprimatur of Jerusalem, they at least needed the contact. They needed the tradition. They needed that connection. And so they welcomed Paul and Barnabas, and in time sent Paul back to Jerusalem to talk to James and Peter to get further correction about what they were doing. And Ray said, even when he was doing it with audiences instead of a book, he would say, and let's face it, Jerusalem never got anything out of it. They got one pitiful little purse that didn't even take care of their needs. But nonetheless, and then he said, and we have to understand that Jerusalem and Antioch never got along. They never really understood each other. They were two entirely different things. Because in Jerusalem, to offer the new Christian to be a rabbi. In Antioch, there weren't any rabbis to do it. And in Jerusalem, you had to be Christian, you had to keep the food laws, keep the law. In Antioch, there wasn't any way there. There weren't enough groceries. And then he would laugh and say, and in Jerusalem, to be Christian, you had to be circumcised, and in Antioch, you've got to be kidding. which was his way of saying that Inherited Church, or traditional church, whatever you want to call us, has an obligation to speak to the very thing you just spoke to. Aesthetics and truth is beauty and beauty is truth, whatever you want to do, is a slippery slope. It's no more slippery, probably, than being factual. In fact, it's probably not as much of a grammar. But there has to be connection between the two traditions. There has to be some sort of organized intercourse, which is why, if I had my way, every rector in this place would be dealing with an emergence body, because I guarantee you, you've got them. Somewhere right under your nose, they're there, and they're waiting to be engaged. And that's one of the things, is unless we can keep those lines open, is there such a thing as absolute truth that can be known by non-absolute human beings? I don't know. They would answer, only the Spirit can take us there. That's the reason that. But yes, the aesthetic thing is absolutely. I'm not in favor of the kid, I'm just saying the kid is the best expression of what emergence means by actual, that you'll ever find.
Your 10 divisions were obviously extremely interesting, but one point about it that I didn't hear was, does liberation theology and the preferential option for the poor, does that belong anywhere in these 10 divisions?
Yes.
You're discerning?
Yes, you can do a whole cascade, if you will. The question was, does liberation theology belong in this? You better believe it does. Some of this Buddhist straight up to you can do the work of Cone. You can go all the way up with the Martin Luther King. It is part of it, of course. Absolutely, it's part of it. And there's a whole cascade that you can do. I did a book that released in September. Called Emergence Christianity, which chases that particular theme, as a matter of fact. Because it's absolutely there. It's absolutely there. You can start with Dorothy Day and Peter Martin if you want to start with it. and the Catholic Worker movement in 32, 33, I guess, is when the Catholic Worker first publishes. But they start in 32, and you can watch it all the way.
I wondered if you could put on like a history of religion tab. I'm no expert in the Hindu faith, but I would say that 500-year cycle would apply to that great world religion.
Yes, and that's an interesting question. As you all hear it, I've heard this before. I don't know enough, even, forgive me, about Islam to know that where the 500 years are. I just take their word for it because they're so insistent. But I also have been told by those who do know that the same cycle applies in the Hindu faith and also in some parts, some areas of Buddhist experience, primarily sections of China. I don't know whether that's true or not. I've never found out a way to actually chase it down and find out whether it's true. If that systems theorists fascinate me because they have solid math for why these things happen. But when you start talking to them, they either get so much mad that I have no clue what they're saying, or they devolve back to the blasted aeroplanes and say, don't you understand, regardless of what we do climate-wise, every 52 years, I think it's 52 years, the aeroplanes are going to renew themselves. They're going to start, you know, they're going to be lush, they get hit by lightning, they burn down, they become ooey gooey water, and eventually the water fills up with a little algae, the algae grows, it begins to get around going, and at the end of 52 years, it's this beautiful part, and it gets zapped again, and there's nothing you can do about it. Well, I don't know whether I want to be a 500-year cycle of the aeroplanes or not, or a reenactment of the aeroplanes, but apparently there's something about the 500 years. That is omnipresent. The only area I know enough to talk about is in the Judeo-Christian and Latinized Christianity, which your point is well taken, and you've got lots of footnotes for it.
So if we were just tentatively going to put that point out there, I'm interested now in some of our Western culture. So as you take this theory, what happens in the theory of world religions to the Roman and Greek gods? What happens to the old gods that they don't get renewed? So I see like some of the great world religions seem to go through renewal of themes in the scripture. I can look at other religions and go, it would appear they are in a state.
Yes, it would appear.
I'm interested in comments you would make.
I don't know the answer to that question. It's a good question. I do know that when the old gods are dying, there is a period in which everybody gets really head up about them. And you know that as well as I do. In many ways, I suspect we're seeing a head up period in evangelicalism right now, as they feel that particular structure is dying. I don't know. Diocletian is obviously the last hurrah of the old gods. He retires in 305 when the persecutions actually start, and they last for some 3 or 4 years. When he's trying to drive Christianity out in order to solidify the empire around the old gods. After that, the old gods disappeared entirely. I don't know whether there was any sign of that or not. I never even thought about that question. It's an interesting question. I wonder if you could go back and discover a pattern. I don't know. I might even know how to trace that one down. I have no idea. I have no idea.
Interesting
contemporary novelists
like Neil Gaiman.
Yeah.
Are
claiming
these are
the area
of fiction.
Yeah. I don't think, even though, as I say, the older trade historians are really scared of cycles, and there's reason for that. In the mid-50s, professional historians started cycling everything because it made great dissertations that were fairly easy to write, you know. And I mean, you would get 2 or 3 year cycles, and it was really trashy. And it got to be just outrageous in the academy to talk about it. Now, there's no question they're cycles. They're just there. So they don't speak as much about historical determinism as they used to. But it's fascinating that I don't know. There's no question that in the popular conversation, there's the looking for patterns. Neil Gaiman and company. There's the looking for patterns. The other question I thought you were going to know is that I get asked every once in a while, does this mean we're going to have, 500 years from now, we're going to have something else? Is it true? I don't know. As rapidly as information is spreading now, whether we will hold to the 500-year thing or not, my gut says probably so, if we're still around. that in 500 years from now we go public. Obviously, Cox thinks that the thing that's most important is that we have changed over in the age of the Spirit, completing the Trinity, and that that's going to be the effective thing, and then we'll continue to do the 500 years. The first evidence that I have been able to find of the 500-year cycle being applied at any kind of parish level is 1969, I believe it is, when Walter Kent did a book under imprimatur for Rica for Roman Catholic catechesis, in which they talk about the cycle. And it's just there. That's the training of young Catholics in the 60s for it. But it definitely was part of the conversation.
Thank you, Phyllis, for sharing. It's been great. I'm just wondering, you know, Azusa and the charismatic movement, Pentecostalism, and the fact that the majority of Christians in the world are from that particular flavor of the Christian faith. So how do they respond to this whole emergence Christianity?
How do they respond to emergence?
Yes.
The Pentecostals, as you know, are more a theological group than they are an ecclesial group. And let me say that Scott McKnight, who is increasingly an emerging scholar, if you will, increasingly moving from being emergent in general to being emergent, a dear friend of the college, in 2006 said in an address at Westminster Seminary that emergence Christianity, the best he could tell, was as much about ecclesiology as it is about theology. And at the time, I thought it was a brilliant statement, and now I think it's even more brilliant. I think it's absolutely right. It's a change in the nature of what we think church is. It's a post-Christendom, post-Constantinian kind of arrangement. So we are readjusting what church means and what it is. Given all that, I think what's happening is that Pentecostalism is a theological bent that's finding its home in many ecclesiologists. Does that make sense? It's not an integer. Now, it's an integer. There are Pentecostal churches, having said, but and there are some denominations, Assemblies of God in Church of God in Christ, Assemblies of God, are beautiful examples of Pentecostal denominations. They got all the stuff that makes them look like it. But the bulk of Pentecostalism is found in the charismatic movement, which is primarily Episcopalian and Anglican, as you know, thanks to Dennis Bennett and Van Eyck in the 50s and 60s. And it's in emergence, where the emphasis on the Spirit has become so dominant that whether you would call all the emergence you know Pentecostal or not, I don't know. But I know every one of them is geared to the Spirit in a way that's very close. It smacks of Pentecostalism. If by Pentecostalism you mean that I believe that the Spirit speaks to me, that I can engage the Spirit, that I can, with two or three friends in prayer, engage the Spirit, that I can indeed heal, that I can do all those things are almost ubiquitous in emergence groups. They really are. So I would say that Pentecostalism, more than being an ecclesial structure, even acknowledging what Scott has to say, it is more a diffusing of a theological point of view over the whole of emergence. I may be wrong. And definitely, obviously, in South America, there are huge Pentecostal churches. In Korea, also. And as you know, John Paul II, when he was just absolutely dying at the end of life, made that torturous trip into South America to try to stay the flooding of Roman Catholics over into what's basically Protestant Pentecostal churches. It was not successful. So it's there. But Pentecostalism and its theology has sure infused emergence right up to the hilt.
Just a follow-up question. I thought I might ask one. I know that there are many. But with the notion of the Christian authority leads through all this and where does one go, then we look at the fragmentation of Protestantism as you've shown it to us, but also the future. Does authority that therefore look like in the future
a fragmentation even greater? And is there, when we say community, I think of an Anglican bishop and a community of faith, not just my local congregation. What I'm hearing is a congregational piety and an increased fragmentation. Is there any thoughts?
You're talking about a consistent and ongoing community that is greater than the local cohort. And those are there, but they are web-based, which may blow your mind, but they are web-based, and they're on there constantly, so that the community now is not physical in its presentation so much as it's electronic, but it's absolutely there.
I'm wondering if it's just raising again, once again, the question of Episcopal orders of essay, many essay, many essay, that ancient discussion, you know, is it essential, beneficial, or absolutely essential?
Well, one of the things that even emergency leaders will say laughingly is that the third law of thermodynamics is going to hold, which is that you can never have perfect order or perfect disorder. And that one of the things they're learning how to do is to come to a sense of order, which is exactly what you're talking about. Will they ever have big judicatories? I doubt it. With the net, they probably don't need it.
Well, we don't. Here's another question.
Thank you for everything that you shared with us. It's been awesome. My question is a little bit related to the previous one, and it has to do with the fact that in this diocese, many of us are involved in the missional transformation process.
Are involved in what?
The missional transformation process. And part of that has to do with living in a tension of uncertainty, that we're invited to go on this process and we don't know, you know, sort of where the goal is, or, you know, you kind of find it as you go. And so, as I was listening, I was wondering, to what extent does, like putting labels on all of this, to what extent does that then give us, like, a sense of then of control, and then not being open to wherever it is we're supposed to go?
Yes, yes. I think it's part of getting to order. It's a good question. Getting it into some kind of order, to give them taxonomy, is to exercise a certain amount of control over it, to bring it into something that we can grasp or that they can grasp. The labels obviously are theirs and not mine. And they self-impose them in an attempt to give orderliness to it. I think that's absolutely true. There's no question. And it goes back to, as you say, it's related to Drew's question. We're trying to get to some sort of sense of order about the whole thing. It can't just chaotically go on forever. But whether that means that that we're controlling it so much as we're just making it, I don't know. I really don't know. I know that they are putting the labels on themselves now, and primarily because they don't want to be confused with each other. It's a strange time. It really didn't matter. All that business about, you know, the division, I would never have done 2 years ago. I'm not sure I would have done it 18 months ago. But now they're at each other in the same way that Luther and Zwingli went after each other. It's the same sort of tension. And it breaks my heart, but at the same time, I recognize it is a sign of maturation. But when you start that stuff, and it's not that one of them thinks the other's going to hell, which is a Protestant approach to it. It's just that that's not the way I'm going to live my life. That's not my understanding of spirituality. And so that it's a fight that's a lot less eschatological, I should say, than the Protestant one is. But nonetheless, it's a sign they're growing up. It's a sign they're growing up. There are thousands and thousands of presentations of emergence Christianity that don't affiliate necessarily with any of these. That is to say, there are if you push them, they would. But there are thousands of hub theologies and yoga club theologies and Starbucks theology groups that would say we're just emergence Christians and not necessarily get in any of these boxes. One of the things that I routinely say, and I said it to our House of Bishops a couple of years ago, and one bishop came up afterwards and said, in a nice way, what you're really talking about is pimping for Jesus. And I said, that's what I'm talking about, you're right. In which I said and mean it, that if I had my way, and the rector was so inclined, every rector would get from his or her vestry a $250 bar bill a month. It's a tough job, but you know. and you go to the nearest pub and you sit down with your car keys and your collar, whether you wear a collar or not, and your collar on the table in front of you, and you have a beer, and you go at the same time, Friday night at 5:30, for 5 or 6 weeks. And if you've not caught somebody, you're in the wrong bar. Go change bars and do the same thing again. Because what you catch will be about the second or third, and it works, and it's 100% accurate, about the third Friday night or whatever night you've chosen, you're going to get somebody who is the church. The Brits separate in their missional effort. I don't know if Bishop Johnson, he and I talked about this one, but you may be using the same paradigm, I don't know. They talk about the unchurched, the de-church, the non-church. We're using them out of mission shaped church, okay. And then, as you know, the non-church are those who just grew up without it. They're innocent, they're tabula rasa. You can do almost anything you want to with them. They're not too concerned. The unchurched are those who moved, and it was a Sunday they moved to the city, and then the next Sunday they had to settle in, and the Sunday after that they had to rest because they were tired, and the Sunday after that the neighbors gave a brunch, whatever, and they ended up never going to church. It's the D church you catch, and the D church, you will pardon the French, are pissed at the church. They are absolutely, they are those who are furious about how it has hurt them, or denied them, or been stupid, or something. And they're the ones who will sit down and talk with you, and they will tell you in a certain language what's wrong with the church, and why you must be crazy to be doing it. And the first thing you know, you'll have three or four, and within 5 or 6 Tuesdays or Fridays or whatever it is after that, you'll have a club theology group. Now, they're tough to work with. I mean, you're working one person to 6 or 8. And they don't fall in these categories. Ultimately, they probably are going to blow apart and make more groups like that. They're sort of the subculture in all of this. Basically, if I had to put them somewhere, they probably emerge up. They're not neo-monastic. They're not small church. They're just this thing out of which more emergence Christians are coming. And they ultimately may land as individuals in one of these categories. But there's this huge substratum, if you will. One of the most fascinating things that ever happened to me was that 3 or 4 years ago, I guess, Sam and I lived in the country, and there's a bar in Memphis, Tennessee, sort of right in the middle of nowhere. Everything gets stripped away around it, all asphalt, this one bar, a Cheers-like kind of bar, which had been having the same customers for years. And I got a phone call one night, and it was the barkeep at Cudson saying, "Miss Tickle, I have a group of customers who are coming in here every Tuesday night at 5:30 to talk God. And they want to know if I would call you and ask you if you'd come talk to them." And flippantly, I said, "Is the beer free?" right out of my mouth. And he said, "No, ma'am." But we went. And every Tuesday night for a year, I guess, we met. And sometimes there were 4 people, and sometimes there were 40. President of the local seminary came, being doctors, including my husband, lawyer, and Vietnam veterans who were totally hopeless and helpless. Every cut of body is like a citizen's group. And when you get 40 people in a bar, it's not fair to the barkeeper, it really isn't. So that may be a little skittish, but because, you know, one night a week I can't get into my favorite bar, so I'm going to go find another bar, right? So it's really not fair. But one night, we talked Bible every single night. I never saw a Bible physically present. But the quotations and the citations were right on, unless I'm crazy, and I don't think I am. I don't claim to know all the scripture. But every single one that I heard was right. It rang true, and so did the citations. They knew they were the D-church. They were angry. But they knew what they were angry about. And then one night, a couple of years ago, one of the guys said, "I think we're through here." And everybody said, "Yeah, I think we are." "Well, okay, we'll just meet on the net." That was it, you know. And things went back and forth on the net, but that was all. Then last month, I got something on the internet that said, "We think we ought to have a little anniversary. Meet us at Cudson's." We all came back and we met at Cudson's for one night, you know. Had a beer together, talked about, and what had happened is that out of that group, three, at least three pub theologies had started in other parts of the Memphis area. It's like a milk pot that bursts, and plants itself otherwise. Nothing. We're not building the structure. We're just praising God, and got them. No, we're praising God and doing this thing. But those don't show up in this scheme yet, per se. And that's the bulk of it. Now, ultimately, I suspect they'll land one place or another, under one category or another. It's a very good question.
You have talked about the Judeo-Christian church and its Latin. And I was just sort of percolating in my head. There are many translations to the Bible, huge amount. And sometimes in a verse, a word changes, and it really does seem to alter the meaning.
Absolutely.
And I wonder, are there different versions of the Quran or other biblical books? And if not, is that significant?
I think it is significant. The Quran, to be the Quran, cannot ever be translated out of Arabic, nor can it be changed in any way. It enjoys a different thing, if you will, a different stature, a different position than our holy text. Now, as you know, even 20 years ago, when I first started this, you couldn't translate the Quran and get away with it. Now there are, in North America, several publishers who are publishing in English the Quran, but it opens up the same thing you just said. It's a different translation of certain words, and when you do that, you change the nature. Obviously, Allah spoke to, or the Prophet spoke, in Arabic, and he didn't speak in English, and so you change it. The whole business of the scripture is up in grasp. I thought you were going somewhere else with your question, because it occurred to me when I was talking about Islam a minute ago. If I read you correctly, from the south of the border, your Sikh population is huge here. We don't have that in the States. You have a much larger one here in this country. And Mr. Harper, if I understood him correctly, in talking about religious freedom in this country and how far your Sikh citizens will be allowed to speak to the possibility of a division in India, the establishment of a Sikh state, analogous in some way to Pakistan, the establishment of Pakistan. So that your problem perhaps, or that the ancient religion is perhaps better addressed in terms of the Sikhs, they're not a big component, and neither is Islam. It is the UK where Islam, in France, where Islam is a big question. But regardless of the community you're talking about, it's a good question. And of course, the Sa'id Baruth, it can't be translated either.
I hardly know how to ask this question, but I'm just wondering, are the people who are would be considered emergents, do they have any unified theology or understanding of the nature of Jesus, for instance? Or you've talked about the virgin birth, we haven't talked about the resurrection, people's. Just wondering if you could comment on that.
I can, and the answer is no, there's not, because there's not a codification. The emergence, one of the characteristics, the major characteristic of emergence, regardless of how it presents in all of its presentations, is that they are narrative and not propositional. And they will defend that to the death, regardless of whether they're, an Aztec, it doesn't matter. It is the story that contains the truth and not the proposition. Give us the dogma, but don't give us the doctrine, kind of thing. So that there is no uniformity beyond the sensibilities. And the sensibilities are very clear. They are passionate about Jesus Christ. You better believe he's God. Don't mess with me. Now, how that happened, Christology, they could care less about it. That's not fair. But an organized, an organized Christology is ultimately going to be people looking at their own labels, so to speak, because we don't really know. It's a mystery. The important thing is the story, and that he is God by whatever mechanism. So, no, you're quite right. There's no credit as such that exists. It's a good question.
It occurred to me that one thing you haven't mentioned is the issue of, it has to do with who human beings are.
Yes.
Is the obligation to bring your to the earth, and that sort of that enlightenment view of understanding the Genesis story, that human beings were kind of parachuting in at the end as sort of the pinnacle, the masters.
Yes. Had a lot of parachuting in between, yes.
Could have dominion. And yet what we have learned since Darwin and up is that that is not true, that we emerged from the earth and are totally dependent on it. And we, the issue of being master and dominator doesn't fit that. It's more steward, nurturer, servant, even to the earth. And in my observation about that movement is becoming stronger and stronger as we're facing environmental crises, that we have to come to another understanding.
Yes, we do.
Enlightenment understanding.
And emergence would absolutely agree with you. There's no question that they would agree 100% with what you just said. Just as they, the part of spirituality is deeply involved with the earth itself, and with protecting the earth, and they will argue that what Revelation actually says is that there will be free intercourse between the city of God and the city of man down here. But this is what we're going to have. This resuscitated, this resurrected is what we're going to have. And we have to care for it, because in that way we're also caring for the kingdom of God. There's a very elaborate set of sensibilities around the thing you just said. They might shy a little bit from your Adam and Eve, though. They might say that what was born in the garden was consciousness. And that it doesn't necessarily, evolution doesn't necessarily preclude some understanding of the Genesis story, pretty much as it was told. But otherwise, yeah, right on.
Probably asking more than one question, but I'm just curious. Some of us have been following certain personalities, like Richard Foster, Robert Weber, sort of evangelical side of things, John Michael Talbot, Richard Rohr, Matthew Fox, sort of Catholic and Anglican perspectives. They do represent this sort of postmodern society approach, and in some ways have a sort of post-denominational quality.
That's right.
And yet, you mentioned before this convergence movement. I mean, and then there's the emerging movement. Where would you say they sort of fit in? I mean,
that's an excellent question. I see the caller now, right? John, one of the things that I jumped, because I didn't think it was time, and every time I jump something, I'm informed that I shouldn't have jumped it. One of the major influences in emergence theology, to the extent that there is, or sensibilities, is Quaker. The Quaker is heavily, and nobody has been more significant in the formation of emergence theological sensibilities than John Weber. It was John Weber who did Bound and Set, Center Set, for instance, that has shaped their ecclesiology in every way. Weber coming out, of course, out of Quakerism, his final step before he went vineyard. Was, as you know, with the Quakers. And so, and the same, even to this day, men like Richard Foster, Philip Gullick, are very influential and are read and respected in the emergence community, regardless of where it falls in the spectrum. There's no question about that. Richard Rohr is a kid. He and I just did, in August, did a week together in Maine. He said to me, you know, I'm quitting. I'm going to stay home in Albuquerque. I'm not going to do the road anymore. And I said, what? And he said, I'll be 70, sweetheart. And I said, you wuss. What are you talking about? You know, I'm entitled to quit. But post-denomination, I think if you pin Richard back to the wall, you find he probably is very interested in convergence. When I, I would love to get rid of the word emergence. I don't think we got a prayer of getting rid of it because it comes up out of science because it's been there for so long. I don't think we can get rid of it. But I'd love to see the word convergence take over. But if you look at men like Eric Zolnitz, if that means anything to you, who did the Phoenix Affirmation, which is kind of the original statement of convergence, it's a 10-point thing, I think. To some extent, Mother Max, and it's been interesting to me to hear McLaurin begin to kind of cozy up to the idea that maybe we have something that not only has a name, a different name, but also that integrates progressive Christianity into it. I can't recommend too much. I don't think it's circulating yet, but she was sure to send it to me. I can't recommend too highly Rebecca King's dissertation on progressives. And Tanya Lurman, M-U-H-R-M-A-N, two is, I think, it, When God Talks Back, is the only, so far as I know, really significant analysis by a good scholar of Pentecostalism and of what happens. And she emphasizes Wimber and the Vineyard as they effectively become the channel for Pentecostalism into emergence, I guess is what you'd say. And stunning work, right up there with American Grace by Putnam, which is the sort of quintessential examination of evangelicalism. The three of them, I wrote King last week and said, please get this thing out where it can be published, because then we would have three major studies circulating, one on progressive and one on
Hi. I want to ask you the three of your laundry list things you're concerned about with this, so I won't go on for this for the sake of time. But to start it off, say one of the things I was concerned about, or I'm concerned about, is view of Scripture. And I came down to this conference in Pendleton Falls, and she said he has one bar and eight churches. So I think we need to rebalance that a little bit. What you said. I came out with a biblical scholar whose work is primarily recontextualizing the New Testament in the context of the empire. Sylvia Kiesman.
Oh, okay. I thought we loved
people. Yeah, yeah. She wrote a book on Romans as well. Colossians 3 things.
Okay.
It's recontextualizing, or trying to capture again the context of, Jesus was Jewish, that seemed to be news in the 70s, and all this happened within the context of the Roman Empire, and then all of a sudden, beyond translations, it actually reveals a whole lots of interesting things about the Gospels that we've just passed by a lot of the Roman context. So, that can hold, but I don't see this necessarily taking hold, maybe it is. What are your three things? The three things that you're most concerned, I guess the three big questions we have to ask. What are the three things on your laundry list you'd like us to be aware of?
It's a good question. One of the things we did not get to, because it's a 30-minute thing minimum, is we didn't get to what it means to be post-constitutional. Absolutely. The 28th of last month was the 1700th anniversary of the victory at the Milvian Bridge. We should all hung black, and we should hang black next February when we have the 1700th anniversary of the Edict of Milan, because that's when the fat really hit the fire. Emergence speak of dual or triple citizenship, according to where they come, in which they say for the first time in 1700 years, we're going to have to now assume the ability to be children of the kingdom or citizens of the kingdom and citizens of the state and see them as different roles. The two are no longer the same. And that's going to change how we practice Christianity. The third citizenship is they also say that there is a non-geographic, non-local, what they call local citizenship, built on the fact that we can have relationships and loyalties that are not local and that are not in any way bloodline. And there's good work on that. But given the two citizenships that they are talking about, the question is, can we learn to live, say it this way, the thing about being post-Constantinian or post-Christendom is that Christianity is going, regardless of what its emergence or not, is going to have to learn what Judaism learned centuries ago, how to be a component element in a society that is not informed by your values, and how to hunker down and to make it distinctive to be Christian. Emergence has said for 10 years that I've listened to it, I don't want a religion that doesn't cost me something. I want some feeling that I mark as different. I don't want to be mainstream, because that's not what our Lord was. And so we're hitting that conversation. When you were going with where you were going, I said, who? I thought you were going to Warren Peterson, who done some really good work in Christianity after Christendom. And so some others, but there's a lot of conversation now. And Emergence are terribly concerned with being sure that we know we are becoming a people of heart. And that perhaps is another role, just as Judaism has.
Thank you very much for your comments today. They've been really interesting. Well, since you said you're not a feminist, but I don't entirely believe you. One reason is that at least two out of the three main questions you said you need to be engaged with, the question of anthropology and atonement, are both questions that have been a major part of the feminist inquiry, theological inquiry for many years now. Are you aware of sort of much concurrence between those two streams of thought and critique? I mean, the sort of feminist theologians have been speaking about in person.
Oh yeah, you get Parker's work, and yes.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Yes. I would not have thought of those, though, as associated with the feminists. That's interesting. I never made that association. I mean, obviously they're there, but I would not have thought. In fact, I'm not even sure that that's true for Emergence. Most of the work coming on atonement now is things like Tony Jones's Atonement by that name, or Scott McKnight's The Community Call Atonement. Those are guys, Brian. It's interesting. I would not have thought of it as in any way connected. But they have been concerned. I suspect if there is a connection, it's because feminism comes up during the period of Emergence, and it picks up in the ambience of some of the theological concerns. I suspect that's why it comes, but I never made that connection. I wouldn't mind being a feminist. It's just not a battle. I'm too old for it to be my battle. But my daughters are quite well, I guess. When I was a lawyer, I wouldn't mess with her for anything. But